Welcome. Join us together with all the rest of our Saviour's Lutheran Church to worship God this day. Please come forward, praise team.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you. Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated for the reading.
The first reading is from Zephaniah, verse 1, chapter 1, verses 7, 12 through 18. Be silent before the Lord God, for the day of the Lord is at hand. The Lord has prepared a sacrifice that he has consecrated his guests. At that time I will search Jerusalem with lamps, and I will punish the people who rest complacently on their dregs. Those who say in their hearts, the Lord will not do good, nor will he do harm. Their wealth shall be plundered and their houses laid waste. Though they build houses, they shall not inhabit them. Though they plant vineyards, they shall not drink wine from them. The great day of the Lord is near, near and hastening fast. The sound of the day of the Lord is bitter. The warrior cries aloud there. There will be a day of wrath. That will be a day of wrath, a day of distress and anguish, a day of ruin and devastation, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness, a day of trumpet blasts and battle cry against the fortified cities and against the lofty battlements. I will bring such distress on people that they shall walk like the blind, because they have sinned against the Lord. Their blood shall be poured out like dust, and their flesh like dung. Neither their silver nor their gold will be able to save them on the day of the Lord's wrath. In the fire of his passion, the whole earth shall be consumed. For a full, a terrible end he will make of all the inhabitants of the earth. Word of God, word of life.
The second reading comes from 1 Thessalonians, chapter 5. Now, concerning the times and the seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you, for you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. When they say, there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and there will be no escape. But you, beloved, are not in darkness for that day to surprise you like a thief. For you are all children of light and children of the day. We are not of the night or of the darkness. So then let us not fall asleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who are drunk, get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober and put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for our helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through the Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing. Word of God, word of life.
Gospel according to Matthew chapter 25.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, "For it is as if a man going on a journey summoned his servants and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1. To each according to his ability. Then the master went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off and at once traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had the 2 talents made 2 more talents, but the one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents and saying, Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made 5 more talents. His master said to him, Well done, good and trustworthy servant. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter the joy of your master. And the one with the 2 talents also came forward, saying, Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, Well done, good and trustworthy servant. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. Then the one who had received just 1 talent also came forward saying, Master, I knew you were a hard man, reaping where you do not sow, gathering where you do not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here, take what is yours. The master replied, You wicked, you lazy servant. You knew, did you, that I reap where I do not sow and gather where I do not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return I would have received interest. So take the talent from him, the master said. Give it to the one with the 10 talents. For all those who have, more will be given. They will have abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless servant, throw him out where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. This is the gospel of the Lord. Friends, let's prepare for the advent of the Lord. It is already the middle of November. We have here a parable that impresses the importance of patience as we wait for the day of the Lord. Matthew 25, starting at verse 14, illustrates the necessity of preparation as we wait. The parable is about servants who were entrusted with a supply of something called talents. But this was a supply of coins that were meant to be put to work. And they were to be put to work without the oversight of the master because he went away on a journey. This parable presses the point of how God's servants are invited to live as we prepare for the advent of the Lord, the day of the Lord. We can understand because we've already heard that God gives us spiritual gifts for a certain purpose, a preparation before the final day of the Lord. We know this. We can understand that after we have received the amazing gift of salvation through Christ that we just read about in 1 Thessalonians, Paul's letter, as we're doing the work of the Lord because we received our salvation, we're also given spiritual gifts for extending the boundaries of God's kingdom. Spiritual gifts are, get ready for a list. Will someone count them with their fingers so I won't fall asleep? Who's going to hold their hand up? Okay. Spiritual gifts are a gift given to every Christian. Look at Ephesians 4. Spiritual gifts are given for one purpose, to build up the body of Christ. Spiritual gifts are never earned and never deserved. Through God's abundant love and grace, gifts are freely given to all believers. Look at John chapter 1. Spiritual gifts are focused on the unifying source of this grace, the source and giver who is God, and not on the gift. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Spiritual gifts are all equally cherished. There is no gift more important than the others, and there is no gift that the body of Christ could ever do without. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, you can see. Spiritual gifts are for serving. Spiritual gifts are the embodiment of diversity. In fact, the word measure, when we read it in the New Testament Greek, is about expanding the boundaries and the gifts in geographical terms. Wow. Spiritual gifts are meant to be applied in faith community. That's 1 Corinthians 12 is 2. Remember, one's gifts, your gifts, any gift that I might have, these gifts are fully expressed when complementing those of other brothers and sisters in the body of Christ. They are always used interdependently, even if we don't see it. They are used to unify and bring to wholeness Christ's mission in all the earth. How many did we have on the list? Thank you. So, Jesus' parable. I need to get back to that one because I need to present to you a premise that possibly too many of us think of the talents not as big, heavy golden coins. But that's what they are. They were the biggest, heaviest golden coins of Judea, Samaria, and the area in Jesus' day. They were big. They meant lots of cash, but the parable is not about cash, and the parable is not about this thing I was told we had in the sixth grade in my public school a long time ago. Talent? This is not a parable about that. Sometime you educators can tell me what those are, because there's probably a definition for public school educators. Is there one for music educators? We'll talk. This parable I present to you as my best advice to you. Look at these talents as big, heavy coins, so big you couldn't put them in your jeans pocket nor your purse. If you had two of them, you wouldn't be able to pick up the purse. Big gold coins. And that they are not about the individual strengths of human beings before they come to Christ. My life pulls this out, so I hope you'll trust me on this. Often you or I might mention someone's abilities and call them talents, but we don't have to call them talents. We could call them abilities, and I try hard to call them abilities. Some of these abilities come to us through our experiences in life. We have on-the-job training in many things. Some of our abilities seem to be the kind that run through families, such as musicality. I don't know about that, but it seems to me that they are genetic, in fact. I know mathematical strengths and genius can run through families. The story, the parable Jesus tells after the parable of the 10 bridesmaids that we talked about last week, the parable is so connected to this one from last week that I've got to refer to it because there's a connecting sentence at the beginning of this one. And it makes it quite clear this is not about stewardship of money, and it's not really about stewardship of your abilities as a person. This new parable that I read to you moments ago is about how we live as we wait for Christ's coming at the parousia, the grand Christmas of eternity. It is about how we wait and how we serve through these days, because we can't possibly serve joy unto God's delight. You know, we can't serve God unto the delight of God if we aren't putting to use the spiritual gifts God has given. And the big one is faith. A lot of people have faith that you don't even know about. You watch them, you find out. The first story that Jesus told, that one about the 10 bridesmaids and their lamps and their need to have plenty of oil so they could keep the lamps burning in case the bridegroom was delayed. That one ends with a rather strange post note. I'll get to that in a minute. But it also gives us a clue about this parable that we call the talents. Our talents, talents like my sixth grade teacher said, like someone who can do their math homework fast. No, not in the Bible sense. These are about the coin of the realm of God. The punchline of that previous parable is, keep awake, therefore, because you do not know the day or the hour. And that's speaking of the return of the bridegroom. I'm speaking of the return of Christ, coming back to the bride of Christ, the church, and the whole world. Last week, I did my best to proclaim that I believe that the bridegroom is Christ, and his arrival is the same day of the Lord that is even proclaimed and prophesied in the Old Testament, places like Zephaniah. Those servants in this new parable I'm reading today were put in charge of large, big, precious gifts. Two of the servants were faithfully working with these coins and bringing them to the bankers and enjoying an increase that they could give to their master at his return. Consequently, when the master does arrive back at the home place, he praises these two servants and says, well done. He even says, enter my joy. The master said to them, well done, good and trustworthy servants. You have been faithful in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. So, my friends, don't forget, there is a third servant in the story. He's the guy that likes to dig holes in the ground. Or at least in this case, he did, because it seemed to me that his self-talk was something like, God doesn't care about me. And Zephaniah had a phrase about that, too. Can God do anything good? Can God really do anything evil? The ancients considered this, and so do we. How could a loving God allow things such as we are suffering to happen in the world? Why do good things not always happen to good people? Why does evil happen to good people? That's the big question, the important mystery, and it's the mystery no one can answer or explain. You can ponder it, and it will do you good. It does me good to ponder it, too. We all have a little bit of negative self-talk, but this man who liked to dig holes in the ground, he seemed to be somewhat resentful because I didn't like the way he wanted to just give back the master's one coin. Here, take what is yours. I didn't like that at all. Fear motivated that servant, not faithfulness, apparently. It motivated him to dig a hole and bury the talent. And it was a little bit like stuffing your spiritual mattress with $100,000 or $500,000, spiritually speaking. Some Christians, in fact, all of us at times, think that God has left us. We stop talking to Christ's other followers around us. We stop talking to God. We're weak. It's a weakness thing, I think, and fear. Sometimes we're tempted to hide our spiritual gifts. Oh no, they might want to get me down here too much at the church. Oh no, somebody might send me out to a place I've never been to try and make things better for people I don't know. Things like that. That's very human too. We all do it. You see, spiritual gifts are not meant to be hidden. Spiritual gifts are meant to be engaged with the people around you in your own faith community, and engaged with people beyond the faith community. You need to be engaged with people in ways such as healing, ways such as invitation into community, hospitality, and definitely the meeting of practical needs. Needs to happen. That's a spiritual gift of generosity. You see, spiritual gifts are meant to be engaged, meant to be applied, meant to be shined up. God wants to do that for you. So here's my list of things that spiritual gifts are not. Would somebody count the list? Spiritual gifts are not a ticket to a private inner circle. Spiritual gifts are not given to each person for anything other than the upbuilding of the church. The Holy Spirit's shopping list. No. Spiritual gifts are not the Holy Spirit's shopping list. Well, it is important to discover and understand how you are gifted by God for the purpose of building up God's kingdom through the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Remember, the Spirit comes in various ways, and every single spiritual gift is absolutely necessary. And there's no need to judge someone else for their gift. I had a seminary teacher who would cry if people would degrade certain gifts in class. And he would tell us, that's God's child. Don't judge the gift. So our choice, we have a choice. Open our hearts and try a little risk behavior, because God seems in this parable to like risk. After all, he trusted those first two servants with big, heavy coins, and they did do well with what God probably wanted in the parable. Remember, a spiritual gift is a supernatural attribute, not one that runs in families or can be acquired through many years of education. I've had many years of education. That's not how we get our spiritual gifts. We just get some knowledge and hopefully some inspiration along the way. So learn this from the parable, that God is kind and God is forgiving, not harsh. God is not miserly. Learn that our generous God lavishes gifts upon the church, such as teaching and leadership and many others. When we do risk the gifts for the kingdom of heaven, we find that the return on our master's investment is great, and God is delighted with them. So in the parable of the faithful servants, God tells those two who got busy increasing the gifts, enter into my joy. Now listen to another reading from the New Testament, the book known as Hebrews chapter 12. The writer tells us, let us run with perseverance the race that has been set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the sake of the joy that was set before him endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God. That's the end of the quote from Hebrews chapter 12. You listening today, thank you. Thank you for listening. You already have all you need to bring forth the increase that God is seeking through your life. You have it already. It could be really fun, and sometimes it might require perseverance. The broader growth of the kingdom and the healing of the world is God's grand mission. We get to patiently participate as we wait for the advent of the Lord. Come on in. Let's sing.
For Christ's reign to come among us, we pray for the outpouring of God's power on the church, the world, and all in need. Lord of the church, ignite your people with the passion of your love. By the fire of your Holy Spirit, unify us across ministries, congregations, and denominations, and refine us to participate in your activity throughout the world. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Lord of creation, we stand in awe at the works of your hands and praise you for the beauty of nature, especially as we experience throughout Wyoming. Bless the earth for your glory and restore its integrity where exploitation has caused ruin. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Lord of nations, sound forth your justice in the ears of all leaders. Increase concern for those who are most vulnerable, especially international leaders, forge trade agreements, and cooperate to end human rights abuses. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Lord of all need, all in need, search out all who cry to you in distress. Scatter the heavy clouds of depression, chronic illness, unemployment, and loneliness with your radiant light. Send us as encouragement and signs of your healing. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Lord of the stranger, stir up holy restlessness in us to extend love to those at the margins. Release our desire for control and open us to learn from the perspectives of others. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Here other intercessions may be offered.
I pray, O Lord, for all the organizations in our city, our state, and our nation, the organizations who help people in need. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Lord of the living and the dead, we give you thanks for all the saints at rest from their labors Rouse us to live by their example, that saints yet to come may also know your love. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Receive our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, until that day when you gather all creation around your throne, where you will reign forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
I want to proclaim to you the peace of Christ, and I want to encourage you to share this peace wherever you go this week. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Generations have turned to you, gathered around your table, and shared your abundant blessings. Number us among them that, as we gather these gifts from your abundance and give thanks for your rich blessings, we may feast upon your very self and care for all that you have made. Through Jesus Christ, our sovereign and servant. Amen.
Amen. Please be seated. I'd like to share with you some good news about the Quilters of Our Savior's Lutheran Church. And also, I want to celebrate quilters from all around the community. When I was younger, I didn't know what a quilt was because we didn't have them. And one time, my mother came home from a garden club meeting. And she said, "We're going to make up some quilts to give away. And it's really easy. Don't worry. All of you girls are going to help me." So my sisters and I and my mother sat down in the big living room around this square quilt. But it wasn't a quilt yet. It was a piece of fabric. And I said, "Mama, what are we doing with this piece of fabric? You told me these were going to be thick." And she said, "They will be." So she went to the back of the linen closet and she got out some blankets that she didn't need anymore. And she put a blanket on top of the fabric and another piece of fabric on top of the blanket. And she said, "Now let me show you how to run yarn through these." So those were the quilts. And I think actually she did some edging when we weren't looking, when we were in school using the sewing machine. Now that is very primitive, but it was a little local gardening club. And they decided, besides giving away vegetables and flowers, they wanted to give away quilts that year in the town where I lived. So when I came here to Our Savior's Lutheran Church in Casper, Wyoming, I was blown away by the beauty of the quilts being made here and have heard that this has been going on for decades and decades, possibly more than 90 years. The leader of our quilting group is Rena Geist, and I want to publicly thank you, Rena, for your ministry amongst the quilters, because it is a ministry of wholeness, a ministry of love and prayer and work and sharing and invitation. and even food. Thank you all of you who are quilters and have been or have somehow contributed to the quilters. And I hope you'll be watching if you're here on Sunday for at least one or two of the quilters to be here, because due to the global pandemic, the quilters are not at this moment quilting in the church. But some of their beautiful quilts are here today. I think you'll be able to see some of them on the photography that comes with this week's posted online worship service. Thank you, quilters, and everyone here today and everyone watching this later. Will you please pray with me a blessing of the quilts for our faith community and for all of them, even the garden clubs? Let's pray. We gather today in the name of you, our Savior. We give thanks for women and men, like those in the Bible, who were willing to use their hands to bring comfort and the gospel. We thank you, Father, for Christian foremothers and forefathers, because they used their gifts to glorify you, and sometimes they used needles and thread and quilting products. We thank you for the women quilters and the men quilters of our Savior's Lutheran Church. Help us today to follow in the footsteps of all these quilting artists. To you, merciful Lord, we give thanks for all faithful people who, even alone in their homes or in small groups, are cutting and sewing together colorful straps of fabric, forming tops with spectacular patterns in gorgeous colors. Lord, we ask for your blessings on all these artists and workers, because we see they create in love. O Lord, source of all comfort, we express our gratitude for the caring people who gather in homes and church basements and fellowship halls to quilt and tie and bind and comfort. Thank you for the quilters, and God, we ask you to bind us all together with hearts of love. We ask you to help us love the people we have not even met who will receive this year's quilts. We ask you to bring comfort in times of stress to those who reside at Casper's Youth Crisis Center. Lord, teach us all to use our gifts to reach out to the world's downtrodden people, the poor in spirit and the poor in cash. Help us to follow the example of the quilters. Lord Jesus, we ask you to continue to bless the work of our Savior's quilters and quilters around the world. We pray for all those who are cold tonight. If we see one, Lord, help us to reach out. This is to your glory, O Lord, forever. Amen.
Join me now in the prayer that our Lord taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Amen.
Oh,
Beloved of God, go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.